Okay, recently Nvidia has once again added one more of those so-called super graphics cards to their, to some already pretty confusing lineup. It seems such a reworked version has now also reached the mid-range or upper low end, however you may want to call it. At first there was the RTX 20 series based on Turing with ray tracing support at hardware level. Then came the GTX 16 series, well equipped without those ray tracing components, also based on Turing. What has belonged to the 16 series up until now were the GTX 1660, 1660 Ti, and 1650. Now Nvidia has released a GTX 1660 Super. That one hardly is any different to a regular GTX 1660, except for the video memory. Instead of using the fairly dated GDDR5 VRAM, the Super variant now sports the fast GDDR6 memory type, as seen on the more powerful SKUs. So those that don't usually follow releases closely might end up a little confused. It sure is getting a bit complicated, if that's the term we want to go for. Furthermore, Team Green blesses us with yet another card in the lower price segment, namely the GTX 1650 Super, which I'll also be taking a look at sometime soon. Today, however, it's all about the Gainward GTX 1660 Super Ghost, so one of the cheapest models that actually comes with not one, but two fans. Also, Gainward GPUs might not be widely available for purchase in the US, but they are over here in Europe. The price at the time of making the video is at roughly $240 to $250. So this for sure is going to be quite the interesting battle, since the regular 1660 can be had for $230 to $240. The 1660 Ti, on the other hand, goes for like $260 to $280. Please keep in mind, I was actually looking at one of the cheapest twin fan models, basically GPUs with two fans for this price comparison. So while I hate the confusion Nvidia is causing, right off the bat I gotta say, today's 1660 Super might not be as bad as some of you may think it is. I can definitely say nice words about Gainward's design choice here, that's my personal opinion. Admittedly, aesthetics shouldn't play too big of a role, but let's be honest, quite a few of us actually do pay a little more attention to the looks than we should. Well, at least I'm pleading guilty to that. Surprisingly, there's no RGB lighting on this card, but this doesn't mean there's no lighting on there at all. We do, in fact, get nice subtle white illumination. Other than this fairly neutral color, there's no other choice, which doesn't bother me at all. Brightness, simply effects, etc., can be controlled in Gainward's so-called expert tool. Obviously, it seems Gigabyte isn't the only AIB that seems to go for a backplate that's not out of metal. They slammed one out of plastic on here. I mean, I'll never really agree with the idea of putting plastic on there as a backplate, but at least it can be said, Gainward didn't do it as cheaply as Gigabyte did, where one could tell it's the cheapest available plastic from a distance of 211.4 meters. In terms of temperatures, the use of plastic sure isn't ideal, deal to say the least, but then again, there's the saying, we eat with our eyes. And given this is a GPU with a TDP of just 125 watts, I honestly have to admit, in this case we hardly should be noticing a negative impact on temperatures anyway. So I guess I can somewhat tolerate the backplate this time around. Just a bummer, unlike other manufacturers, Gainward didn't decide to implement semi-passive cooling. At idle, passive operation sure wouldn't be a problem and would translate into a longer fan lifespan and less unnecessary dust buildup. While the two fans are whisper quiet under light loads, they never turn off. Under full load or while gaming, the fans do become very noticeable though. They're not the quietest, but not the loudest or most annoying either. So all seems okay so far. So as you can see, in terms of specs, there's hardly much of a difference between the GTX 1660 and the 1660 Super. It's just that the Super version received a giant VRAM upgrade. Both models still come with 6 GB, whether that's enough or not really is debatable, but the point is, the upgrade from GDDR5 to GDDR6 leads to a huge boost when it comes to memory bandwidth. With GDDR5, for instance, we are talking of 192.1 GB per second, whereas with GDDR6, it's a whopping 336. Therefore, the following test result should be pretty damn interesting, because actually we are testing the same exact card equipped with different types of memory. So is the regular 1660 being bottlenecked by its slow GDDR5 VRAM, or is GDDR6 just some kind of money-making by Nvidia? Is it worth the upgrade? Let's find out. short answer, yes, GDDR6 in the case of the GTX 1660, or rather 1660 Super, does bring an immense boost in performance. Performance-wise, we consumers actually don't get to see anything new here, since Nvidia has released the GTX 1660 Ti for this specific performance class before, but undoubtedly, with today's 1660 Super, we see some very respectable frame rates at about $250 pricing. This makes it a fantastic full HD 1080p graphics card. Close to every single game plays well at 1080p at maxed out or high graphic settings, even the new very, very performance hungry Red Dead Redemption 2. But even for the next higher resolution level, 1440p WQHD, the 1660 Super does a great job. At least for the majority of game titles, albeit, you will have to reduce some of those graphics details because not all of us actually feel comfortable gaming with less than 60fps. Alright, there's not a whole lot to say about the offered performance. Power consumption and temperatures are looking good too, nothing to complain about here. It's just that I don't quite understand Nvidia's strategic move. The 1660 Ti already existed. In the majority of tested games, the new 1660 Super is pretty much just as good as the 1660 Ti. Nvidia offers us consumers two graphics cards with close to identical performance capabilities. That's good and all, but none of the mentioned graphics cards replaces the other. All of these just strangely coexist. And now hold on tight, the 1660 Ti, even though it pretty much delivers 1660 Super performance, costs more. That's confusing, so here are the prices at the time of producing this video. So when going for the mean value, the average between minimum and maximum of realistic pricing, the new 1660 Super goes for like $245, the 1660 Ti goes for about $270, and the regular 1660 for roughly $235. So from a price performance perspective, neither the 1660 nor the 1660 Ti make much sense anymore. As things are looking right now, I can only advise you to go for the 1660 Super. I find this to be a strange move by Nvidia, since they are pretty much sabotaging their own GPUs, but who knows, we might see some adjustments in pricing in the near future. Luckily, we consumers don't have to care about that, as long as price and performance are good, that's all what matters to us. So in my opinion, there's really not much you can do wrong by going for the Gameboard GTX 1660 Super Ghost. I can even give it my Gold Award. As always, thanks for watching and see you in the next one.